Ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to please close your eyes as I sing and think of the ways that Peter Ahn has inspired you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'd like to begin by acknowledging my wife, Jean, Peter's family and friends, including his sisters, Claudette Mazzariti, Louise Crowley, who couldn't join us this afternoon, his lifelong friends, Norman Larilla and Rob Westerberg. We will hear from his niece, Jackie Monteleone, shortly. I'd also like to recognize Gail Brewer, Manhattan Borough President and a GS alumna, trustees emerita, Abigail Black Elbaum, George Van Amsen. I'd like to recognize George Rupp, President Emeritus, his wife Nancy, and the many deans and administrators and alumni students and special friends here today. This is a sad day for Columbia, but also a good one too, because it was always a good day when you were around Peter. And I know those are the feelings shared deeply by thousands of Columbia alumni, students, faculty, and staff, and certainly the thousand gathered here today. On behalf of Jean, myself, and the entire Columbia community, I want to recognize and express our sympathies to Peter's closest friends and family, Claudette Mazzariti, Louise Crowley, Jackie Monteleone, Norman Larilla, and Jacob Westerberg. There is so much to be said about Peter, and so much more that cannot be reduced to words, because in the end, it was Peter's unique and really indefinable presence that touched all of us who encountered him. His laugh, his gait, his nervous intensity, his socks. Peter, I'm wearing this tie today in your honor. He simply charmed us with all of his exuberance, his universal warmth, and his loving and lovable generosity. People like Peter are never gone, even though they may be in a physical sense. As much as I wish I could, this is George's tribute, I cannot take credit for appointing Peter as Dean of General Studies. But I did reappoint him and would have continued doing so forever. He was one and the same with the school. You couldn't really separate them in your mind. Peter knew two important things. He knew that with the School of General Studies, he had something unique because the students of General Studies were unique. People whose extraordinary talents and drive to learn and succeed had awakened in them at an age other than 17, their special talents, and who could feel that sense of justice when the world is right because there actually is a place where you can fit in and be recognized for what you are. And he knew that the only thing he had to do was to make everyone else in the world realize and appreciate that fact. Peter set about this methodically. Like all good revolutionaries, he had a slightly subversive streak in him, which was critical at Columbia for accomplishing what he set out to do. Before you knew it, the school had become larger, and everything about it was more consequential. He set his sights on the right goal of infusing the General Studies undergraduate educational experience with all that Columbia had to offer. There were, to be sure, untold opportunities to enrich the programming curriculum offered to GS students, and Peter seized them. Joint and dual BA programs with Sciences Po in Paris, the City University of Hong Kong, and Trinity College Dublin. A post-baccalaureate pre-medical program and access to the full range of classes and opportunities offered here to undergraduates and many more. But Peter's vision was larger. One of Peter's great gifts, born of his personality and experience in life, was that he seemed to understand GS students, their motivations and their concerns, even before he met them. and so he turned them into his revolutionary forces. Not only has general studies been successfully integrated into Columbia and its greatness, but the greatness of Columbia has now been enhanced by the presence of general studies. On so many occasions, I have found myself recounting the wonders of Columbia University and speaking proudly, and I must say eloquently, of general studies, by channeling Peter, as it were. And after I finished, it was always as if I could see Peter walking away with his special way of moving briskly, shaking his head, with pleasure and satisfaction, and a smile of knowing accomplishment that his pupil had done well. In his final dean's letter published in the OWL Alumni Magazine, Peter wrote the following. After almost 40 years in the faculty and 20 years as dean, I can say without hesitation that GS has now taken its place at the heart of Columbia, and that the mission of this unique college is an essential part of what makes Columbia a great university. The undergraduate classroom at Columbia is unlike that at any other Ivy League university because we take diversity to its logical conclusions. By integrating age and experience into the intellectual discourse among students and faculty, this full integration represents to me the cutting edge of undergraduate education and deserves to be emulated at other highly selective colleges and universities. And so it was revealed that Peter's path was not just integrating general studies into Columbia or transforming Columbia's sense of itself and its greatness, but of reforming all of higher education. And then, of course, would come the world. And so it will come to pass. There's a famous line I often quote and I love from Montaigne: in the closest of friendships, you can't tell where you leave off and the other person begins. And that was true of Peter's relationship with the institution he led, completely enmeshed. He saw the potential of general studies, how all the elements were in place to do something that had never been done before in higher education and the world. At the most basic academic level, Peter understood and grasped the power of discussing the Iliad with a student veteran and reading Medea with a mother of two. He envisioned a school equal to the untraditional students it served, and he made it a reality. But he also understood the national healing that needed to take place between the academic world and the gay communities and the military, and he helped enormously on that mission. Peter Ahn was that rare and special person who leaves many legacies. But it must also be said that in his own person, he was such an incomprehensible mix of personal qualities and life experiences, an ex-Jesuit priest and a scholar of Islamic studies, that his life, like his socks, was always a surprise. And all this made him, more naturally, the very embodiment of a humanist, in the true sense of that word, as a person who relished the realities of the diversity of humanity. Each fall, when the remarkable students of the School of General Studies arrive, sometimes for the first time, some for the first time, some returning after summer break, Peter would tell all who cared to listen that general studies students are a gift to our university community. He believed this in his soul, and he was right, of course, but with one important caveat. For the two decades that he led this school so magnificently, the greatest gift General Studies gave to this university was its dean, Peter Ahn.
Peter Ahn grew up in a family of Lebanese Christian immigrants. Lebanon, then as now, relies on tolerance and understanding to survive amid religious differences and sectarian strife. Peter experienced Christian beliefs and traditions as a Jesuit priest, then turned to a deep study of Islam, earning his PhD in Islamic and comparative religion at Harvard. He came to Columbia in 1978. The place has never been the same. Peter's dissertation, soon a prize-winning book entitled Satan's Tragedy and Redemption, Iblis in Sufi Psychology, delved deeply into the role of the devil in Sufi mysticism. But Peter's scholarly work ranged very widely. He lectured to diverse professional and academic audiences on the role of Islamic religious beliefs in shaping the political and social development of the Muslim world. Above all, Peter was a great teacher and educator. Generations of Columbia students took his popular course on Islam and graduated with a far deeper understanding of the Middle East and the world. He mentored doctoral students in comparative religion and taught undergraduate core courses in literature humanities. He won great teacher awards. It was not long before the Columbia University leadership recognized his talent for making things work and took steps to exploit it ruthlessly. Peter became the quintessential university citizen, taking over as Dean of the School of General Studies in 1997, but also serving shorter gap-filling roles as Director of Middle East Institute and Acting Dean of the School of Professional Studies, and he served on innumerable committees investigating innumerably interesting things. His signature multicolored socks began turning up everywhere. And as they did, Columbia began to change in wonderfully unexpected and positive ways. Peter's modus operandi mixed unrelenting cheerfulness, razor-sharp logic, and a unique capacity to manage well. Visionaries and innovators do not always run things brilliantly, especially in universities where we often recruit managers from the ranks of the professoriate. Peter turned out to be the exception. Most importantly, he took over GS at what turned out to be a crucial moment in its history. Columbia had created the School of General Studies after World War II, basically for veterans on the GI Bill. Unlike peer institutions, the other Ivies, for example, Columbia kept GS open even after the wave of veterans receded. Now aimed at non-traditional students, GS lacked a coherent vision until Peter moved in. Peter simply transformed the place. He celebrated GS's diverse and talented students and made them his priority. He boasted about their accomplishments wherever he went, and he sought out ways to make GS serve them better. GS became the place where Columbia introduced innovations in undergraduate education. I will mention just three of many. First, Peter moved to remake the GS curriculum to bring it closer to that of the college. He insisted, and he was right, that GS students wanted and were fully capable of meeting the rigorous demands of a Columbia degree program. Second, Peter leaped at the opportunity to make Columbia accessible to veterans again by actively recruiting veterans in GS and by creating a Center for Veteran Transition and Integration. Today, GS has more student veterans enrolled than all of our peer institutions combined, and the CVTI is contributing to veterans' transitions throughout the country via partnerships with veterans' organizations, as well as community colleges, NGOs, the Veterans Administration, and the Department of Defense. Third, as Lee Bollinger mentioned, Peter and his team made GS the go-to place for curricular innovation, the place where new programs could be introduced with minimum hassle and paperwork. The results were especially noteworthy in the development of new international dual degree programs with partners in Europe and Asia. GS developed the first of these programs with the outstanding French university Sciences Po. An equal number of French and US citizens do their first 2 years at the Sciences Po campus in Reims, then move to New York for their last 2 years and graduate receiving degrees from both institutions. This program has been so successful that Sciences Po has decided to name the auditorium on its Reims campus after Peter at a ceremony later this year. To cite the letter from the Sciences Po president announcing this decision, I quote, "Peter always expressed great pride in the Sciences Po Columbia dual degree program, and his legacy will live on in our students and alumni for many years to come. His mentorship, charismatic presence, and genuine kindness were an inspiration to students and staff alike," end quote. Peter and his team created similar dual degree programs in the City University of Hong Kong and Trinity College Dublin, and I understand there are two others that are underway now. In these and so many other ways, Peter's wisdom, sound judgment, keen sense of humor, and deep commitment to serving students profoundly shaped Columbia for the better. We miss him already.
When I was a college student in the late 1990s, a teacher introduced me to the idea that Iblis, the Islamic equivalent of for Satan, was actually the best of Muslims because he refused to bow down to any being other than God. I had never heard such an idea, and I was instantly intrigued. And when I followed up, I was given a book. That book was Satan's Tragedy and Redemption, and it was written by Peter Owen. The book did not disappoint. It was a remarkable examination of the complex role of Iblis across the Muslim tradition, focusing on classical Sufism, but also incorporating Jewish and Christian sources. This book, published in 1983, remains one of the definitive and canonical modern studies on Sufism. So much so that in the religion department, we still receive doctoral applications from students who wish to work with Peter, citing the breadth and depth of this work. Peter Owen was a long-standing pillar of Islamic studies. He completed his doctorate in Harvard in 1978, where he worked closely with the great German scholar of Sufism, Anne-Marie Schimmel, for whom he had many, many scandalous anecdotes. He then came to Columbia, where he published several seminal articles, as well as the aforementioned book. He threw himself into teaching, focusing on his introduction to Islam, which acquired an almost legendary reputation. Peter had a thoroughly unique presence and an amazing knack for presenting information without losing the interest of an audience. He was completely invested in his students, famously grading and commenting on every single final paper himself. Sometimes this would number nearly 100. Peter taught this class for decades, spanning multiple generations of a single family. When I took over the course in 2015, it was daunting, but Peter was very supportive. Still, just a month into the class, a student dropped by my office and expressed her disappointment that Peter was not teaching the class. Apparently, her mother, father, and older sister had taken Peter's class, and he still remembered all of their names. The quality and lasting influence of Peter's scholarship speaks for itself. His skills as a teacher are also unquestionable, as his many students will attest to. I was not one of Peter's students, but I did have the honor of being his colleague for 10 years. Not a long time, but enough to appreciate Peter's care and concern for his colleagues, as well as junior faculty. And is this an aspect of Peter that I would like to speak about in my remaining few minutes? When I first arrived at Columbia in 2009, I was overwhelmed. I was a young assistant professor at an institution dominated by established figures in my field. I spent my first semester reaching out to those colleagues in Islamic studies, often unsuccessfully. Some never responded. Others suggested that I come by office hours and introduce myself. I understood this, I truly did. They were all busy and they had little time for someone like me. In the midst of this, at a point where I felt a real kind of isolation, I received an email from Peter Owen. He asked me to lunch at Faculty House, where he spent 2 hours with me discussing pretty much everything. my own anxieties, his experience as a young scholar at Columbia, department gossip, because Peter loved department gossip. He seemed to always know what was happening and why. He simply made me feel like I belonged. It was an important moment for me personally, and an incredibly kind and generous gesture from Peter. And I don't even think Peter realized how much it meant. It was just Peter being himself. Over the next 10 years, we would meet at least once a semester for lunch or coffee, where he would provide reassurance, advice, and encouragement with his characteristically dry wit, sarcasm. He had a lot of sarcasm. When, after a long hiatus, the religion department once again began accepting doctoral students to Islam in 2014, Peter was thrilled and took an active part in recruitment, although he didn't have to. On numerous occasions, he took prospective students to lunch and made the case for why Columbia was the ideal place for them to be. As I got more acquainted with Columbia, I was shocked by the extent of Peter's footprint. I was struggling to balance time commitments, but Peter was everywhere, at all times, doing everything. He would guest lecture in a course at Union, or help a journalism student working on Ahmadis in Pakistan, or he would sit in on a thesis defense at the last minute because somebody was needed, or he would be giving a talk at some local Muslim community organization just because they asked. I still don't know how he managed to do it all. Over the last 2 years, the religion department was blessed with Peter's return as an active member of the department. He took part in admissions, displaying an uncommon and sharp discernment, attended department meetings, and brought a welcome energy. He remained as sharp as ever. We were thrilled at the prospect that he would be returning to the classroom next year. I think I speak for the department as a whole when I say that we will miss him greatly. And on a personal level, I am heartbroken to have lost not only a generous, kind colleague, but also a very supportive friend. Thank you.
It is a deep honor to speak today about the tremendous legacy of my beloved predecessor, Dean Emeritus of the Columbia School of General Studies, Peter J. Ahn. It is so meaningful to have just heard the words of President Bollinger, Provost Coatsworth, and Professor Haida. Without a doubt, Peter has changed Columbia for the better in so many ways. Thank you, President Bollinger and Jean, for hosting today's memorial service. I vividly recall my first meeting with Peter when I was still a finalist for the deanship at Columbia GS. Of course, as an alumna, I knew firsthand all about Dean Ahn and what a legendary dean he was. As I shared with Norman, Rob, Jackie, Michelle, Claudette, and the rest of the beautiful Peter J. Ahn family, upon meeting them at the hospital, Dean Ahn was the rock star of deans, truly a combination of Bon Jovi and Freddie Mercury. Maybe a little more Freddie, but. I knew that if I were to become the ninth dean of GS, I would have big shoes to fill, but really, as we saw today, really cool socks. In classic and generous Peter Ahn style, before I could get any words in at that first meeting, Peter immediately said to me how thrilled he was that I may be the next dean. He complimented my record of scholarship, experience as a department chair, but what he said was truly momentous for GS at this time is that I would be the first alumna dean. Peter shared with me in that meeting what we all know to be true and what we heard President Bollinger say today, that there is nothing like Columbia School of General Studies in the Ivy League or among elite institutions in general, and that while GS transforms the lives of students that walk through the doors in Lewison Hall, he would always say the very presence of our veterans, dancers, or as Peter called them, our tutus and uzis. Dual degree and other students that follow non-traditional paths make the Columbia undergraduate classroom like no other. At this meeting, I remember that I was shocked that Peter's office was already empty and I was still just a finalist, except for his standing up desk and computer, and he said he was preparing for this transition. He said that he wanted to make sure that the new dean would have space for their own vision and that he would just spend the next year lurking in the bushes outside Lewison Hall if anyone needed him. The truth is, when I had the honor of being selected as dean, I, like everyone else, could not picture GS without Peter and wanted to spend every moment that I could learning from him and just spending time with this brilliant man and absolute mensch of a human being. I'm so happy to say that Peter did stay very engaged in my first year as dean. Even though he was on leave, you heard all he was doing in religion, he could have been in some place like Hawaii, or for Peter, it would have been Paris. But until his tragic end, when he was hit by a car on January 25th, in my first year, like he did when he was dean, he was at all our student events, honoring our students, watching them get inducted into GS Honor Society, selecting our students for Phi Beta Kappa, working with students on theses, writing numerous recommendation letters, attending our class days. He even visited regularly our treasured GS Student Lounge, which was created under his deanship. I would often see him at breakfast or lunch meetings, always with students and or alumni, and helping them to plan their careers, applications for fellowships, or just helping them to understand the complex and crazy world that we live in. He also loved the students who graduated from our school, our amazing alumni, and during this last year, I watched him present the Owl Award to Christopher Riano at our reunion, present the Alumni Medal Award to Joseph Ehrlich, scream with joy when Karen Yardi-Milo was awarded tenure at Princeton, and by the way, she's coming to Columbia next year, and celebrate when our alumnus and vice chair of our Board of Overseers, Pavan Surapaneneni, became a partner at Sullivan Cromwell. Peter could not be more proud of the accomplishments of our students and alumni. As you can see from this first year, and without a doubt, the characteristics that truly set our dean on apart were his warmth, wit, and never-ending dedication to our GS students and alumni. He set this foundation for GS, and it is evident in everything we do every day to support students at GS. Peter built an exceptional team at GS in Lewison Hall, and he inspired and provided the space for our GS team to develop new programs, such as the Columbia Center for Veteran Transition and Integration, and built with our Vice Dean, Curtis Rogers, a sophisticated admissions and recruitment program that has led to Columbia GS being the destination place for recruiting student veterans, where we currently and so proudly have almost 500 undergraduate student veterans, more than four times in the whole Ivy League combined. Dean On with our team at GS built upon the successful dual degree program with the Jewish Theological Seminary, which I'm a proud graduate, to innovate, create, and launch our international dual degree programs with Sciences Po, Trinity College Dublin, and City University of Hong Kong. As you heard earlier, Dean On took on the bold issues, from fighting for the rights of transgendered students to supporting the opening of a food pantry in Lerner Hall. It is only Dean On who could have the gravitas, the elegance, and the courage to be the person who was a loud voice in both bringing ROTC back to campus and being the faculty member to cut the ribbon for the Donaldson Lounge for LGBTQ students in Shapiro Hall. On that note, I've had many students in our LGBTQ community say that they felt at home when Dean On at orientation would speak about the controversial time when the president of Iran, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, came to Columbia. During his remarks, Ahmadinejad commented in a very horrible way that there was no gay people in Iran, and Peter would say he knew it was a lie, he would tell everyone, because Peter himself had been to Iran. I I can't tell you how much that means to so many. Peter used this visit, a controversial one to say the least, as an example to students that Columbia University is precisely the place where students will be expected to be challenged, a place where they will encounter ideas they agree with and those they disagree with, even ideas that they may find abhorrent and offensive, because that is what it means to be educated, to be challenged, and to constantly reevaluate or reaffirm what it is you think you know. Dean Ahn worked tirelessly to ensure that our GS students would have the same opportunities as other undergraduate students at Columbia University, including participating in the Columbia core curriculum, to moving to a shared committee on instruction with Columbia College. And I should also mention that Dean Ahn made sure that our GS students knew how much they were adored and respected by our faculty. He would say time and time again that the faculty in the arts and sciences are GS students' biggest champions. And I knew if he was here today, he would say thank you to the faculty. Peter was driven by academic excellence and innovation, but more than anything else, he cared about the support and success of his students and alumni. This love for his students and alumni and the deep relationships he formed is shown by all the people in this room today, by the many weddings for GS alumni he officiated at, by his presence at the Veterans Day and Pride parades. So I spoke about the first time I saw Peter after learning I was a finalist for the GS Deanship. Now I will speak about the last time I saw Peter. Curtis Rogers and myself had the privilege of meeting with Peter an hour before the tragedy on January 25th. We met from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. in my office, what used to be Peter's office on Lewis and Hall. Curtis and I were getting ready to travel to Europe to meet with an alumna and to visit our new Trinity Dublin dual degree program. An alumnus heard that Dean Ahn was in the house. I have no idea how this happened, and he just stopped by to thank Peter for a recent recommendation letter. I listened with joy as Peter shared with this alumnus that he planned to teach Lit Hum in the fall. This is not surprising. Teaching and working with students were at Peter's core, and it was so wonderful, but now bittersweet, to hear about Peter's plans to teach. During our meeting, I asked Peter to help me tie the bow on our gift for our alumna, and he did so with precision and perfection, which is so Peter. We had a great meeting speaking about the latest developments in GS, some of our recent student accomplishments, and of course, as the last professor said, we spent a few minutes catching up about the latest gossip in the arts and sciences. Peter recognized that we still had major challenges ahead, including the need for better financial aid and housing for GS students. But on this last day, where he looked so dapper in his suspenders, and yes, cool socks, he walked out of the doors of Lewis and Hall with a smile as he watched the GS flag, which he helped put up, fly high. He left us at 6 p.m., and tragedy struck only minutes later. I found myself at St. Luke's much of the night until Peter was transferred to CUMC. I want to thank the doctors and nurses at CUMC who provided exceptional care for Peter during his last weeks. I also want to thank our Columbia Public Safety for all their support throughout this tragedy. If there is a silver lining to such a terrible night, it is that I met Peter's magnificent family. As many of you know, or you think about it now, you'll think that Peter kept his world separate, almost like a separation of church and state. To his family and close friends, we learn that he was known as Uncle Pete, who was adored by his little nieces and nephews. They knew he was a beloved dean, but they had no idea that he was the rock star dean. We said right from that first night that we would look forward to Peter waking up, and we would tell him the good news is that he's still alive, but the surprising news is that his personal family and his work family had now come together. We only half made it, but I am so happy that Peter's beautiful family are here with us today. I want to thank all who were at the hospital and Peter's family and friends during those last weeks. I know so many more of you out there wanted to be present. I think back to that last day when I saw Peter, and I am reminded that in many ways, Dean Ahn gave us so many gifts and tied so many bows for thousands of us at Columbia over the years. There are few people in this world that I can say have had such a tremendous impact through his personal relationships, teaching, scholarship, service, and to our social structure here at Columbia. As we reflect on Peter's legacy and heal from our loss, I encourage all of us to honor his memory by embracing the opportunities to reevaluate our beliefs and to celebrate the amazing possibilities that occur when we open our minds and our classrooms. Thank you.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. All these are, but I do want to say to President Bollinger, excuse me, Provost Coatsworth, Professor Hyder, Dean Rosenmetsch, members and close friends of the Ahn family, my fellow members of the Columbia community, it's a great privilege and an honor for me to stand before you today to share some thoughts on the amazing impact that our dear friend Peter Ahn had on so many of us in the course of his remarkable life of service and devotion. I've organized my remarks around the idea of the paradox of Peter. And by paradox, I mean a seemingly self-contradictory circumstance which, when you come to fully understand, it makes perfect sense. So paradox number one. When I first met Peter approximately 22 years ago, just after he began his 20-year tenure as the Dean of General Studies, the first thing he said to me was, "You must be Bruce Lawrence's brother." To which I responded, "How could you possibly know that?" The answer was that my brother, like Peter, is an Islamic studies scholar, and like Peter, also an ordained Christian clergyman, albeit a Duke professor and an Episcopalian, while Peter, of course, was a former Jesuit priest and at that point a Columbian. They had come to know and admire each other in their professional world well before I had the good fortune of having Peter become a part of mine. So my first experience of the paradox of Peter was confronting the duality of his personal faith and his chosen field of academic study. It was a paradox I was somewhat familiar with, so I can't say that I was baffled by it at the time, but I was thankful that I had some understanding of how the opposing elements of that particular paradox could be reconciled. At that same meeting, there was another paradoxical circumstance which escaped my notice, but which my good friend and fellow general studies supporter many years, Susan Fagan, recently brought to my attention. Susan and I had spent many years collaborating on efforts to generate financial support for general studies, and she had counseled Peter prior to that first meeting to buy a suit and wear it to the meeting. Peter had dutifully complied with Susan's suggestion, but what I failed to notice were the sandals and the brightly colored socks, which he chose to accompany his new dean-like duds. We all came to understand, of course, as been remarked on many times today, that the socks were the defining element of Peter's wardrobe, no matter what the occasion. So paradox number two, Peter's warm, spontaneous, and welcoming spirit were like his socks to his wardrobe, the defining element of his personality. One time when I was introducing Peter, I likened him to another famous Peter. No, not Saint Peter, the founder of the Christian Church, although our Peter was indeed a rock, and a rock star, as has been noted, but Peter Pan. His eternally youthful, effervescent personality, the slightly mischievous twinkle almost always present in his eyes, the soft, deep chuckle which signaled his delight at the turn of a conversation, all these traits evoked the comparison I made that night. On the other hand, once, in an expression of ultimate and joyous admiration, he said to me, "You know, underneath all this, I am a complete control freak." But that Curtis is even worse than I am. Curtis, of course, is Vice Dean Curtis Rogers, Peter's everyday colleague for 18 of the 20 years he served as dean. And yes, both were true. It was Peter's steely resolve, his unrelenting pursuit of what he felt was right, and his complete joy in seeing those labors bear fruit in both individual and organizational contexts, which buoyed the infectious enthusiasm he so effortlessly conveyed. So Paradox number three, and the final one, you're almost there. But I think the ultimate paradox of Peter is evidenced, and I have to say this has been somewhat astounding to people on both sides of this particular issue, and it has been remarked on today, by the separateness he maintained between his large, loving family and personal friends on the one hand, and the legions of loving and appreciative admirers he interacted with in his professional life. As you've heard today, every stratum of the GS and broader Columbia communities, students, alums, parents, faculty, administration, anyone at all who had the pleasure of experiencing even a few moments in his company. But until Peter was lying unconscious in the hospital after the accident which ultimately claimed his life, these two parts of his world had never connected with each other in any meaningful way. How and why could this have been so? Well, I have a theory, but first let me share with you the experience which brought this realization home to me most emphatically. On March 29th, 6 weeks after Peter's passing, my wife Sally and I, along with 400 or 500 other participants, attended the 9th Military Ball, an annual event celebrating Columbia's distinguished student veterans and alums, but also open to all members of the broader veteran community, whether in the immediate New York vicinity or farther afield. The ball itself has become a continuing testament to Peter's amazing work in helping to build the vibrant community of Columbia veterans we have today. The dress code was black tie or military dress, and those vets who chose the former typically wore their service medals on their jacket lapels. The mood was definitely celebratory, but also poignant, as it always is, as signified by the traditional missing man table, a table set for one near the entrance to the dining area. The symbolism of the table was described to the assembled throng as the evening began. The table is round to represent the everlasting concern survivors have for the missing. It is covered in a white tablecloth to symbolize the pure intentions of service members who responded to their country's call of arms. A single red rose in a vase symbolizes the blood that service members have shed in sacrifice to ensure the freedom of their country. A slice of lemon on the bread plate represents the bitter fate of the missing. Salt sprinkled on the bread plate symbolizes the tears shed by waiting families. An inverted glass represents the fact that the missing and fallen cannot partake. A lit candle symbolizes a light of hope that lives in the hearts to illuminate the missing's way home. After some introductory remarks and dinner, the sergeant at arms, a Marine in full dress blues, called to the stage all the past presidents and current officers of the MilVets organization, the student group sponsoring the ball. On this occasion, all had selected some appropriately gaudy socks to go with their black tie or military dress attire. When all were assembled on stage, the sergeant called out Peter on. Hearing no response, he called out again to a room in complete silence, Peter J. on. Still no response, so he then called out a third time, Dean Peter J. on. After a further moment of silence, taps were played and a folded flag, the traditional military honor, was presented to the table where Peter's family and friends were now standing. At this point, as you can well imagine, there were no unwet cheeks anywhere in the house. And at this point, Peter's family and friends and his colleagues of many years were united in their sorrow at Peter's passing and in their celebration of his amazing life and the impact he had on the lives of so many others in a way which was truly not even imaginable a mere 6 weeks earlier. So back to the paradox and the poignant irony that Peter's passing affected the joining of the two most beloved parts of his world in a way that would never have been possible while he was alive. In his message announcing Peter's passing, President Bollinger commented that, quote, during his 20-year tenure as dean, Peter came to personify the school's character, its values, and its mission. In every way that mattered, he and the school were one. He went on to say the rare gift Peter was able to bestow upon generations of general studies students was his unconditional belief that Columbia was better for their presence, and his insistence that they believe this as fervently as he did. And herein, I believe, lies the key to the paradox, or at least my theory of it. It's my observation that the spirits and sometimes the bodies of almost everyone who has ever walked through the gates of the Columbia campus on their way to Lewis and Hall have previously been wounded in some way. Peter understood this, as only someone who had experienced it himself could have. And he was able to convincingly convey the hope and promise of the ability to overcome these wounds as only someone who had been successful in doing so himself could have. So why did Peter almost never talk about one part of his world to the other? My firm conviction is that it was a manifestation of Peter's attitude that it was never about him. For him to have conveyed to his friends and family the accomplishments and accolades they only began to glimpse in the days just before and ever since his passing would have seemed to him like a form of self-congratulation or self-promotion that was totally foreign to him. And likewise, perhaps, bringing his friends and family into the stream of discourse with his professional colleagues, even his right-hand man and alter control freak, Curtis Rogers, would have seemed to him an imposition on their time and resources, and perhaps an implicit request for personal consideration, which he did not want to make. And all of this, I think, is consistent with the mindset of Peter's first chosen profession, which required a completely selfless devotion to the service of others. First as a priest, then as a scholar and teacher, then as the leader of a flock of non-traditional students, a role in which he exemplified the concept of leadership as service rather than as a quest for any form of individual glory or recognition. So Peter, my good, my excellent, my extraordinary, my paradoxical friend, thank you for the many blessings you have bestowed on all of us throughout your amazing life. Thank you for your service to us individually and to each and every element of our community. Thank you for the beacon you have been and for the healing and redemptive impact you have had on so many of our lives. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Jackie, and I'm one of Peter's 9 nieces and nephews. Actually, I'm the one who shared a birthday with him. I'm standing up here with others in my family, my husband Vince, my sister Michelle, my cousin Peter, and his wife Kristen, who represent all of us who love Peter and miss him terribly. On behalf of Peter's close friends and family, I first want to thank President Bollinger and his wife Jean for hosting this beautiful memorial service. And thank you to the Columbia community, all the participants, and everyone who's in attendance at today's event. While this is a personal loss for us, we are so grateful to see firsthand the impact Peter had upon Columbia and the School of General Studies. Thank you to everyone who made today possible. When we were young children, Peter created opportunities for us to speak at important events. Because of that, I have always been comfortable with speaking in front of a group. I'm grateful I'm able to share one of the many gifts Peter gave me by speaking here today. It's quite amazing that I'm speaking here today, especially since I knew when Peter interviewed at Columbia. We wrote letters back and forth when I was young and he was in Boston. Here are a few lines from a letter he sent me in 1978 when I was just 8 years old. I was in New York yesterday to look for a job. I went to a big school in the city and I had an interview with the teachers. I also had to teach a class so they could see if they like me. They told me that they would call me next week and let me know if they want me to come teach there next year. I will let you know what happens. I think I would like to come back to New York if I can. Then I could see you and Michelle and your mom and dad more. That would be fun. And you could come visit me at my school and see the big library. It is huge and filled with all kinds of different books. Peter was a remarkable person, and I'm so grateful he was my uncle. He had a tremendous impact upon my life. When I was young, he bought me gifts that included dolls and puppets, books, a microscope, and piles of art and historical postcards from museums. When I got older, I understood he opened up my world by introducing me to so many different things, not being sure which ones would stick and have a major impact on my life. Those postcards were something I treasured, and as I continued to learn about art and history in college and beyond, I could easily see that the seeds for that interest were planted by Peter. Peter was much more than that to me, but maybe like you, in many ways, I consider Peter to be one of my greatest teachers. My relationship with Peter has evolved a lot over the years. Now, when I think about Peter, I first hear his big laugh. I can picture him playing and joking with his young grandnieces and nephews. I hear the cadence of his voice, and I picture his gestures. I can feel his love for me and our family, especially when I think about those moments when he pulled me aside and said, "Okay, how are you really doing?" And of course, how can you think about Peter without thinking about those socks? What I've learned in these past few months is that he was very much the same person with the same qualities when he was with his Columbia family and when he was with our family. I can speak for Peter's close friends and family when I say we're so grateful to Peter's Columbia family who have embraced us, supported us, and have gone through this journey with us. There are so many people who we met under the most difficult of circumstances, and I was so grateful that we bonded quickly over our love and care for Peter. We want to extend a special thank you to everyone in the Columbia community who supported us when Peter was in the hospital, and to everyone who has helped us more recently. Our family is also extremely grateful for the care by the doctors, nurses, and staff at the neurological ICU at the New York Presbyterian Columbia University Medical Center. We have never seen a team work so hard and with such expertise. We're so grateful to the Columbia community for this day. I am sure that Peter would be honored and humbled by this event and by this outpouring of love for him. On behalf of Peter and his close friends and family, I want to thank you all.
I get to feel a little bit like a Baptist preacher in this moment and just say amen after all of the wonderful, wonderful tributes and remembrances. There really isn't much more to say. We will have an opportunity after this ceremony to gather in a reception, and I hope that we will there continue to share funny stories and good memories of Peter on. Please stand for a moment of silence as we each in our own way remember Peter. Please be seated. Hear these words of faith and comfort as benediction from the Psalms. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And from the Quran, we belong to God, and to him we shall return. Insha'Allah. Insha'Allah. Go in peace and in celebration of Peter's life. Thank you.